Hello, everyone. We're going to be looking at the South in the Chapter 9 sexualism part of this chapter. We had already covered both the North and the Northwest, and looking at the industry that was going on in America and also the agriculture that was expanding in America. We also looked at immigration and how immigration was affecting the amount of population that it was expanding, mostly in the North. And now we're going to get into the big aspects of South, and really South society, politics, and economy. Okay, so obviously the one big thing that we need to know about the South is its importance with slavery and importance on how slavery affected its economy, the South. Pretty much we call this King Cotton, because cotton was so much a king, or so much a large part of the Southern economy. It wasn't the only part, but it really dominated Southern economic systems and structures. So there's other things in the South's economy as well. So obviously there was rice and tobacco and sugar, and there was about 15% of the economy based off of like textiles or industry. But by the 1820s, really cotton had overtaken any of the South's other endeavors. And really the big connection or this contextualization for this would be the cotton gin. And obviously this short staple cotton that was now able to be grown in the other parts of the South and be able to be harvested and then basically, you know, de-seeded with this cotton gin allowed for this rapid expansion of the cotton industry. Obviously, there's a huge connection to the North with this as well, because obviously the North is going to rely on this cheap cotton, the New England states and their textile mills, and of course Europe too, especially England, where pretty much almost the majority of English cotton, or cotton that was being used in English textiles, was coming from America. That was a huge benefit for England to have this availability of cheap cotton, and also New England as well. And in this map, you see that there is this big sort of push of cotton production, where there's just a little bit in South Carolina and Georgia prior to 1820. But by 1860, you see that basically cotton had spread throughout Georgia, Alabama, and really up and down the Mississippi River. Also in Texas, too, this is one of the big pushes of why many people settled in Texas, was to expand the cotton plantations into East Texas. And of course, as the rise of King Cotton happened, we see the population and also the South basically not just being Virginia and South Carolina and North Carolina, but really going into the Deep South, where we see a much more expansion of the Deep South in this time period. And again, the reason why cotton is king, like we talked about, is that by the Civil War, two-thirds of all U.S. exports, not just the Southern exports, two-thirds of all U.S. exports was cotton. So you see how large of an importance this was on international trade. Obviously, you can't talk about the cotton production and expansion without talking about how it was connected to slavery. You see two maps in this. You see the map of 1790, where you see slaves. Again, there's a little bit in the North. You see some in New York and Pennsylvania and, you know, and New Hampshire and Connecticut. But you see the most of the slaves in the coastal areas of the Chesapeake Bay. That was where all the tobacco production was. And the Sea Island areas of North and South Carolina, the coastal areas, this tidewater area, you could say. You also had some slave areas on the Ohio River in Kentucky. As we see going into the Civil War, we see slavery pretty much dry up almost altogether. There was some still slavery going on in New Jersey and Delaware at the time of the war, but pretty much slavery had ceased to exist in the North. But you see the massive movement of slaves from the North, like Virginia, North Carolina, Maryland, into the Deep South of Louisiana and Alabama and Mississippi and South Carolina, where in South Carolina and Louisiana, slaves actually outnumbered white population in those states. And so you see the massive expansion of slave population in You see the massive expansion of the slave population in Mississippi, you know, going from 32,000 to 430,000. Alabama, 41,000 to 431. And you actually see a decrease in states like Maryland and Delaware and Virginia. They still have slave population, but just a decreasing amount. So pretty much what Virginia is doing is selling off all their offspring slaves. Anytime a slave would have kids, they would sell those off into slavery, into this new region, the Deep South regions. And just so you have another ideology of what Southern economy was like, there was other things going on. There was a small manufacturing sector, mostly in Virginia, but a little bit in Alabama too. There was some transportation. Again, there was some railroads, but very, very little. Almost no canals at all. Very few railroads. And again, most of the shipping was done up and down the Mississippi River. So they were very limited with their transportation. Again, mostly relying on proximity to rivers. And you'll see that right there, that before the Civil War is 1960 or 1861, the red, or 1850, you see very few trains going through the South. You had a couple that were the connected ones that would connect the North and the South, but very little. You see only really two lines connect the North and the South together within this time period. But you can see the North, you have massive amount of railroads that were being built in the 1850s and 1840s. And we just see how much cotton dominated the South. And of course, you look at the type of production, tobacco, rice, sugar, cotton are all plantation-based crops, cash-based crops, obviously using slave labor, where corn, wheat, dairy were pretty much are non-slave, comparatively, crops, and obviously are using more free labor or basically paid labor, with the North. Okay, slavery is a peculiar institution. So a couple things about slavery in this aspect is that slavery had become this whole aspect of slavery, and you see that on the cotton field with the slave driver right there and slave family or a group of slaves harvesting this cotton. It was called peculiar, as in strange or weird or sort of like different or odd in a more special way almost. When I say special, I'm not trying to put light to the gravity and the horrors of slavery, but special as in it was different than maybe other countries or sort of in its ideology. For one, really we were the only European-style nation that was not free of slaves. So you basically had all the other European countries banned slavery from their countries. Only really three major countries in the world still had slaves: Brazil, Cuba, and Puerto Rico. And Cuba and Puerto Rico were basically Spanish territory or colonies, and so was Brazil too. And so pretty much all these independent nations had gotten rid of slavery. You also see the commitment to defend slavery was extremely rooted with the labor system. But eventually, as labor became more abundant, slavery wasn't always needed for a labor need. So we call this the necessary evil or positive good, where at the early on in slaves' existence, we see that a lot of people justify slavery as a necessary evil. We don't like it, but we need it for labor purposes. But as labor became more abundant with the influx of Irish immigrants, how could we justify slavery as a labor need when we had all these workers coming in who could work the fields, in theory? Well, they started justifying this as, oh, well, Southern whites were taking care of slaves. They were giving them religion. They were giving them family and structure and housing and all these positive gains. So obviously, this was a justifiable thing that they used to justify the horrors of it. They would also slightly start treating their slaves slightly better to back up this justification as well. So as slave population increased, and especially as slave population increased compared to white population in the South, many states, like I said, it got very close to half the population being slaves. Again, with South Carolina and Louisiana being actually over 50% for part of their statehood. To control the slaves, we started creating more strict and harsher and more defined slave codes, basically legal codes to define slavery. So we see that the slave population increased from 1 million to 4 million in those 60 years. And so do the laws increase as well, basically to keep slaves in their place, to keep slaves on the plantation, and to make sure that slaves do not gain too much right, because with more rights could also form possibly rebellions. And typically we see most of the slave plantations closely related to the river systems as well. One, you had to have water to irrigate the crops. So that was the needed thing. Also transportation, where all this cotton and all these other goods would have to be transported to the major ports or the major transportation hubs. And the best way to do that was not by roads, but by waterways. So you see most plantations butting up against some type of river, if possible. Also, you see that typically the plantation was not fully dominated by one crop. They would have one large cash crop, in this case, they would have cotton. And then they would farm the other parts of their fields, typically with some type of food crops to basically feed the slaves and feed the big house. And sometimes they would have two crops. For example, this one plantation has a rice plantation as well. And you see this historical picture of all the different plantations. You see they're really long and narrow. The reason why they're created long and narrow is to give as many different plantations access to them, this Mississippi River right here. So a lot of times you would see, again, the plantation system, instead of like wide square-like plots of land, they'd create them really long and narrow to allow more and more planters to have access to the Mississippi River or any other river systems that they would be using. Okay, on the plantation, typically slaves were organized in either task or gang systems. It really depends on the type of plantation you're having and the amount of slaves that you have. Typically, you have a smaller amount of slaves. If you only have a few slaves, typically you put them in the task system. If you have a large plantation, much more likely you're going to have a gang system for work. This picture right here, you see that there is a man on a horse, usually a white foreman. Sometimes this is actually a black slave as well. This is the gang system. You have one person watching over the slaves as they work to make sure that they're working efficiently, productively, and not like, you know, taking time off and stuff like that. So the task system, basically slaves were given a task, they were given the task in the morning, and they had to complete it. If they completed it early, then they could go about their business, tend to their own families, make their own food, tend to their own lives. Sometimes it would take, you know, into the night sometimes, so they weren't done until late at night, and that was sometimes as well. The gang system was different, where you had a group of slaves all basically driven by an overseer or a driver. And they would work until they were told to stop. So they'd be working again. This could be a 12-hour day, a 14-hour day. They were working until they were told to stop working. And this was the typical system in the cotton industry. Again, in smaller plantations, in smaller farms, you wouldn't have one of, you know, an overseer, just it wouldn't make sense. But this was typically in these larger plantations where the gang system was used. Here's a task system. You see just these slaves working on, I'm not sure what they're doing here, maybe like these ladies are doing something, probably food prep or some sort of looks like. And then here's the gang system, like we saw in that other picture as well. Okay, slave women were also a big part of the slave family and the slave culture as well. So one thing about the women, typically women would work in the house when given the option. Obviously, it would also work on the plantation as well, but women dominated the house when there was a house slave that was needed. Also, slave women were also needed to do their own tasks within their own houses. So it was a patriarchal society even within the slave families. So a lot of times, a woman would have to be working all day within the house, with the big house, and then they would be released for the day, and they would have to then be the mom, the wife, the caretaker of their own house as well, and still work with them, you know, making food and tending the kids as well. Some of these house slaves, it was actually physically easier work. They were inside. again, no air conditioning or anything like that, but the inside, they weren't doing the manual labor. But it was a much more mentally strenuous job. And the reason why is that when you're a house slave, you constantly had the overseance of a mistress, of a, not a mistress, but of the missus, of one of the masters. You were always having somebody that was right there who could watch on you. As a plantation slave or a field slave, you had much more leeway maybe to have more time to talk with your other slave friends who are there, or be a little bit off task at times. So mentally straining-wise, house slave was probably much more of a harder mentally strained job. Some of their roles were, they were nursemaids, which means they'd milk the babies. They were nannies. They were cooks, butlers. Coachmen would be the people who were driving the carriages to the town and stuff like that. And in some cases, they would even have separate quarters for the house slaves, because again, if you're a nursemaid, you had to be in the house to tend the baby in the middle of the night. So sometimes these house slaves would not go back to their slave quarters for several days. So there was a lot of times in isolation that they felt. Here's some of the nursemaid, coachman, and a butler. One other problem with being a house slave was that you had a closer connection with the master himself, which meant, in many cases, many times the male master would sexually abuse the female slaves. For the most part, I would say 99% of the time, maybe even more, this was non-consensual. Again, that means that was not wanted on both parties. Probably once in a blue moon. I mean, there was. I've read reports and read some primary source documents that there actually was an attraction by both the slave and the white master. Again, this would be very, very rare, though. Again, this would not be one of those things that would be a normalcy. And of course, one thing that was really bad. So, if you were a female slave who was raped and abused sexually by a master, not only were you abused by that one male master, but in many cases, the female who is the wife would also abuse you as well. And here's the reason why, is that because it was a patriarchal society, they couldn't take their anger or take the problems out on their husband. They knew they had to basically allow it to happen without saying a word. And so what the white woman, the man, would do would basically take her frustrations that her husband is having an affair on her, or basically having sex with the slave, not on her husband, but on the slave herself. So a lot of times the white lady would beat or increase her workload or just psychologically abuse the slave, because there could not be any negative things being put on the husband himself. A really horrible situation. Okay, it wasn't like all slaves were plantation slaves. There were some people who lived in cities in the South, in the larger cities like New Orleans, Richmond and Charleston. And so there was some city slaves as well. Typically, city slaves worked on their own without much overseeing. They were given a task, for example, maybe go do these errands today or do this stuff today, and they would have to go out to do it. Also, in many cases, city slaves were also hired out as hired laborers, or if you're a person in the South in a city maybe like New Orleans, and you had several slaves, you could hire those slaves out as dock workers for the day. So then you could get income from that labor. So many slaves were hired out as hired hands through other people that had businesses in the South. Again, slavery in cities typically declined, and most of the African Americans in cities were actually free African Americans who decided to stay in the South as freemen, not move northwards. And of course, slaves had their own families on the plantations as well. Again, most cases they developed traditional families with traditional roles, like a single father, a single mother, getting together and marrying. Sometimes, of course, they could be split up, so families were broken up. And also, there were some untraditional families as well, where maybe there was sexual relationships without the physical marriage as well. And also, of course, because white masters were having sex with their slave mistresses, many slave women would give birth to mulatto children, but basically a half-white, half-black child. That child would be treated as a slave, typically. They would not be given the benefit of being a relative of the master. And the free African Americans. Obviously, freed African Americans were in existence. Most lived in the Upper South, or they lived in the North. A few lived in the Deep South. Deep South being like, you know, down Georgia, Alabama, you know, Mississippi, Florida, those areas. Most lived in poverty. Some, every once in a while, were actually taken back into slavery. Sometimes they were able to buy their freedom, for example, and then in some cases they were taken back into slavery because just they could. You know, white slave catchers could like say, oh, you're a runaway slave. We're going to catch you and bring you back into the plantation. That was rare, but it happened. But they still had to sort of abide by those slave codes. So there was limits on curfew. There was limits on owning guns, limits on going to certain stores. So they had a lot of limits. And of course, as slavery got more entrenched in white society and American society, so did resistance. However, though, most resistance did not end in rebellion. Most resistance was one of three things, either running away, which is part of this Underground Railroad. Again, we'll talk more about that in a couple chapters. Sometimes it'd be like breaking tools, working a little slower, performing tasks incorrectly or improperly, just sort of being a bad labor. Not so bad that it's so blatant that you're going to get whipped, but just bad enough to slow the production down or make it frustrating sometimes for the masters. And again, that's the normal. There were a couple slave rebellions as well, though. Here's a couple of them. Here's three. Probably the two that get the least amount of attention are Prosser and Denmark Vesey Revolt, because both of them never really started. They both were failed before they even started. They both were found out about and stopped before they could even get started. In 1800, Gabriel Prosser tried to gather about 1,000 slaves. The plan was found out, and the militia stopped him before he got started. In 1822, a man named Denmark Vesey helped rile up about 9,000 slaves, and basically the plan was thwarted before those slaves could actually start a revolt. So both these are failed rebellions before they even got started. The one rebellion that actually went on and actually happened was Nat Turner's revolt. It happened in Virginia in 1831, and this revolt is where slaves rose up, stole some weapons, and actually were able to kill some of their plantation owners and then leave. It didn't really get very far because federal troops and militia were able to stop it within a short while. 60 whites were killed on this. Of course, a lot of the slave revolters were also killed or put back into slavery as well. And of course, whites, however, were very fearful of this from happening. So they extremely cracked down on harsher slave codes, not having slaves congregate, taking away any ability to have slaves have education, and also start putting more fear into white landowners about any type of thing that could spur revolt. So like, for example, when there was starting to be that abolition movement in the North, they were really fearful that, in theory, this could get down to the South and start up another revolution or another revolt, in theory. Okay, so the South was not just slaves. There was white society as well. So the white society in the South was dominated, and this is where the society part of this essay is coming in, dominated by the planter aristocracy. Okay, this is big. And this sort of schematic here, this chart, is a really important one. So you see the white class structure in the South. So about three-fourths of the population never owned a slave ever. So you see most of the people in the South did not own slaves. And you see about 70% had 1 through 9 slaves, so very few. And only a few, though, only about 7%, or maybe 6.7% of the population actually owned a considerable amount of this chunk. So most of the population owned very few or no slaves at all. Where, you see about 7% of the population own a great deal of slaves. So this is where it dominated the societal structure, because you had these small amount of people controlling so much of society based off their wealth and their ownership of slaves. Again, this meant that only a few controlled the economic and political power of the region. So even though slavery dominated politics and society and culture of the South, very few whites actually benefited it from this slave system directly. So this planter and plantation aristocracy. Obviously, this planter class would be very much compared to their, you know, the English and nobles and gentries of the land. They lived on huge plantations with sizable mansions. And part of this was also, a lot of this wealth was based off their land, not so much actually cash money. So a lot of these plantation owners were new money and didn't really have a whole bunch of capital in reserve. Most of their capital was in their slaves, the amount of slaves that they had. So they bought a huge number of slaves. So they may have 200 slaves, and most of their capital was built into that slaves and the land that they had, where they had very little money besides their commodities of slaves and land. So the system of slavery was dominated about keeping those slaves and land, because that's where their money was tied up into. And here's some of these large houses. I think there's mansions in the cities as well. And in the South, there was this cult of honor, this whole idea of Southern gentleman, a way of life. And this had not really to do with slavery, just this different type of gentleman code of honor, the chivalry that was embedded into Southern structure, especially the elite, where almost you had to defend women, you had to defend the role of the South. It was very much based on like the defense of the system. One aspect of this that came into actually politics is you had this Preston Brooks, who felt like that a Northerner was slighting the South. And the Northerner was a Massachusetts Senator, Charles Sumner. And what Preston Brooks did, he came into Congress and started just beating Charles Sumner with a cane, and almost to death. And in the North, this was lauded. This was, you know, criticized as, wow, how could a Southerner do this? In the South, this was praised as like, this guy, Preston Brooks, was defending the South's honor, defending the righteousness of slavery, defending why Southerners do what they do. So you can see it politically, this whole aspect of like slavery crept itself into almost all aspects of society. There's a cartoon of Preston Brooks beating down Charles Sumner. The Southern lady was extremely isolated. It was an extremely patriarchal society, almost even more so than New England was in the colonial times. And women were really put into this role, especially plantation women, of being almost needed to be isolated from society. Women, like, again, I like this quote, women like children have but one right, and that is the right to protection. The right to protection involves the obligation to obey. So the white master would basically think that this woman had no say of her own. And one thing that we had to do as white masters was to protect our ladies. Because the plantations were so spread apart that people had very little connection to their neighbors and each other. There's very few cities to congregate in. And so there's a lot of isolation there. And you could say that slavery helped dominate society, because the plantation system is that people lived apart from each other because of plantations, or sort of plantation because of slaves. And so there's less connection in the South. Also less education too, because there's less city and less need for that, because there just wasn't as much need. There's less schools, less education. Many more Southerners were illiterate, for example. And of course, most of the population was not rich planters. Most of them were plain folks. Most of them were yeoman farmers, which meant that these were small-scale farmers who probably had no slaves at all. And if they had a slave, they probably only had one or two. They typically were subsistence farmers, meaning that they farmed pretty much just enough to live off of, with very limited amounts of goods to be sold. Sometimes they would have, let's say, like about 80% of their land be for their food, and 20% of their land be for cotton. And so to get their cotton milled and then, you know, use the cotton gin, they couldn't afford their own cotton gin. So in many cases, this connected them to the planters because they had to use the planter's cotton gin to be able to then, you know, basically refine it before it could be sent off. So that's one connection that we see the plain folks to the planters themselves. And this would be like an example of a plain folk family, a yeoman, you know, southern family. You also had hill people too. So this was the extreme. These were the extremely, extremely poor families in the Deep South. Most secluded, they tended to live like off the grid, way in the Appalachian Mountains or the Ozarks. And typically they were just getting by with subsistence. They didn't really produce anything at all for sale. Extremely disconnected to the southern economy. And these were the one group of Southerners who typically did not support the Confederacy or the slave system as a whole. Typically, they were almost off the grid. But they were the smallest population of the South. And here's really big. Here's maybe why you could talk about or bridge economy and society together. Connection between the plantation aristocracy and the plain folk. Most yeoman farmers relied on plantations for the use of cotton gin, seeds, and credit. Most Southerners voted. So why would a Southerner who didn't own slaves vote to keep slavery in existence? All rallied around this deep-rooted paternal society. The lowest class were looked down upon. And was limited class conflict because all groups saw slaves themselves as ruling race over African Americans. And that's your connection there. Even if I didn't own a slave, even if I was lower than the planting class, I still wasn't the lowest group in the population. I still was one rung above slaves, right? Or two rungs above slaves, one rung above free African Americans. And you have the poorest whites in society being the hill people. They're being the crackers, the sandhillers, the hillbillies, the poor white trash, the clay eaters. And again, this is just some of the nicknames you could call these hill people. Okay. Real quickly about the West, there was some, these are what they see in the West. We'll talk about the West a little bit in class tomorrow. Again, it's really short though. There wasn't really much, but we were running slaves in the West. But we'll talk about the West tomorrow. What I want you to look at tonight though is this essay prompt. Did slavery dominate every political, social, and economic aspect of Southern life? That is your question. Tomorrow in class, we'll break this down and set you off for the weekend to be able to answer this correctly. Okay, there's your lecture. Have a great day. We'll see you guys on Friday during class.